Hey, everybody. Welcome to Roger and Me, a celebration of the late, great Roger Ebert, keeping his unique spirit of film criticism alive twice a week, on average, mostly, through his own words on his seminal television program, Siskel and Ebert, and every iteration. That's every Tuesday, not this week. This is a Friday episode, and every Friday, we review every new movie that is out in theaters, and or maybe sometimes they also debut on streaming or on paid VOD. The idea is we're covering things that are theatrically released exclusively, but it's tough these days to categorize all these types of releases. It's very confusing landscape for a movie viewer these days. But we have four movies this week, which is a buck in the trend for us. I think we've done seven every time, maybe six or something once before, or maybe it's always been seven. But my guest for every Friday has been Mark Dujsik, film critic of markreviewsmovies.com, and he's back yet again. Hello, Mark. Thank you for being here.
I'm back.
You are back in the saddle again.
It's a nice slow week, which is always good. And it's I thought there were going to be more of them, but no, because next week we're getting right back into a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah, next week there's a slew of indies that are being slipped out that we've already seen. So, like, I'm hoping we still have the energy and the movies in our minds to talk about next week, because the recording schedule is a little wonky for us. But the big release next week is Barbarian, which I'm very excited about. It's a horror movie, which is my bag. It's directed by Zach Kreger of Whitest Kids You Know, the sketch comedy group, but it's, like, not at all a comedy from what I can tell. I haven't watched any trailers, but there's also Medieval, I think, comes out next week. Is that right? Yeah. The Ben Foster. We've got Clerks 3 on September 13th, my birthday, a Tuesday, I believe. It is playing across the nation in a Fathom event. So you can see Clerks 3 September 13th, and I believe the next day as well, before Kevin Smith goes on like his usual, I'm taking my movie on the road, and you can come watch it with me for like $50, and you know, we can hang out, and you could applaud like seals at all the references that that are here to please you. And God, there's a few others next week.
Yeah. But, next week will be a nice packed show. This is just
a nice packed show.
Nice, comfy review show.
Exactly. This one's a little cozier. I'm trying to think if there's one. There's at least one here that I'm pretty passionate about you should watch, which is nice. But, you know, that's not saying a lot out of four, but we're going to get into it. The four movies are probably four you haven't even heard of. Let's go. Burial. Honk for Jesus, Save Your Soul. Waiting for Bojangles, which is such a funny title for what that movie is. And Saloum, I believe is how it's pronounced. It is a Shudder release. Is that right?
Yeah, Shudder and IFC.
And IFC, which
so it's
means...
IFC distributing theatrically, Shudder streaming, obviously.
Okay, so it's not on Shudder yet.
Not yet.
Got it. I wasn't sure. So, Saloum, if you're lucky enough to be in a city where it's playing in a theater, I'm assuming New York City or L.A., perhaps Chicago, maybe not.
Not yet.
Yeah. So it's a very limited release for Saloum, but we're going to talk about it and know that it is premiering on Shudder on September 8th. So that's a week, like less than a week from today of this episode's release. So we'll try and we don't spoil anything. So we're not going to spoil it. We'll hype you up for it or we won't. Spoiler alert. I'm not trying to get ahead of anything. Doing a lot of vamping ahead of the episode because it's going to be a short one. What else do I have to say? Shout out to Banshee Beat. Thank you for the theme song. I love hearing it every week. And I hope all the listeners do too. Thank you to everyone giving us reviews on iTunes and rating us on Spotify. Please keep doing that. It is huge for the show. I appreciate all the 5-star reviews. And we've got our official first 1-star review from a coward who did not even leave a review. They just 1-star rated and left. So shout out to my enemy, whoever you are out there, who is either spite listening, hate listening, or just not listening and rated it anyway. Love to have haters. We have our first hater. And I'm very happy to see that. We're breaking through in some way. All that housekeeping.
Another milestone.
Another milestone. Every week, a new milestone at the show. We're having a great time. I think we should get right into the episode. 5 minutes of vamping over. We did it. And it's time to talk about Burial. This is another IFC release, but it's under the IFC Midnight arm. Was Saloum also IFC Midnight? Or was it just IFC?
I think
IFC
so. Yeah, films? I'm pretty sure. I think like the next couple of things that we got from IFC are Midnight.
That's my shit. IFC Midnight.
Next week is another one. It's crazy. Anyway.
I'm excited for next week too. Not to belittle this episode with its really interesting set of four movies. Here we go. Here's the trailer for Burial. The only person you may have heard of in this, I would say, is Tom Felton, who plays Draco Malfoy in the Harry Potter films. Here is the trailer for Burial.
There's been a change of plan. Transport by plane is no longer an option.
I thought the time was of the essence.
It is far more important to get it back as quietly as possible. This is a ticking bomb liable to blow up if we are not careful.
Why do we bury it every night?
Someone kills us in our sleep. They still might not find it.
Get up.
Where are you going?
To find supplies in the village. Spoils of war.
It's not safe. We need to protect this.
Ooh, what's in the box? It is kind of an operative question at the center of the movie Burial. Which leads me to rearing up, get my pitching arm out. I'm going to lob something at Mark.
Okay.
Mark, what's Burial?
What's Burial? Burial is a World War II era drama / thriller / semi-horror movie, kind of eventually / action movie about a group of Soviet troops and an intelligence officer played by Charlotte Vega transporting a mysterious box from Berlin right at the fall of Berlin in 1945 following Hitler's death by suicide in the bunker back to Moscow so that Stalin can see what's in the box. And every night they have to bury the box, as we heard from the trailer, because there's a chance that a lot of people want what's in the box. And so just to make sure that nobody steals the box, even if they're killed, they bury it every night before going to sleep and keeping watch. It's a really intriguing premise, mainly because of the mystery of the box, which apparently isn't much of a mystery based on some of the materials that are going out, but I'm going to leave it as a mystery. At least. I'm not sure about you, because the movie doesn't reveal it until more than halfway through, I think.
That was the first question I had for you. I haven't watched the rest of the trailer even. I haven't seen any of the materials. So I was going to ask, do you think this movie, you kind of agreed with me right away when I said what's in the box and that the mystery is at the center, but I even questioned that a little bit. I'm like, does the movie kind of tip its hand immediately? And like, you're kind of like, are you supposed to infer what's in there? Because I kind of had the guess, and I would say my guess ended up being right. And I'm not sure if that was just like, I happened to guess it correctly, or if the movie was like signaling that that's kind of what is happening.
I think there's definitely something to it. I wonder if, because what I didn't mention and what we haven't gotten to, and I think it's the most interesting part of the movie, which is not saying much about the rest of the movie, but there's a prologue and an epilogue that take place more contemporary. So it's like 91. It's right at the fall of the Soviet Union. And so you have the character, the Vega character, as an older woman, and breaks into her house, and he is looking for evidence that Hitler survived.
That's right. The frame story.
And so in theory, yes and no, you kind of have a sense of what could be in the box. It's either is evidence.
And the box is a coffin, to be clear. Like it's clearly a coffin. And that also implies what might be in there. So, like, I know we're walking around it and we're not going to give it away, and I don't want to. But I would say, with knowing what's in there, it makes the setup even better. And I think it's awesome. Okay. And it sucks to me that the execution of this movie is, like, completely dull and lifeless. and so just boring. It's a boring movie about a really interesting time period with a really interesting, like, historical fiction, or is it type of, you know, or is it setup, like a premise. And it has like a couple energetic moments where there's action and, like, you know, it's surprisingly violent. It's like flirts with that violent exploitation horror element, but it only flirts with it. It doesn't really go all in on it. And there's just so many, it's just a lot of people talking to each other, and like, it's nowhere near as compelling as a movie with, I'm not going to spoil it, the setup that it has. It should be much more entertaining. And I was definitely disappointed by it.
Yeah. I didn't quite buy, I didn't find the argument for transporting that thing as convincing maybe as you did.
It's silly, for sure. I guess. I just think it's like, it's silly in a way that I think is ripe for a fun horror exploitation movie. And this movie is not that at all. It is not trying to be fun. It is just like, it's trying to be like dour and like, in a way that like World War II movies can be, of course, because it's a dour time, but it's just, it's not the action movie you want from it. It's not the horror movie you want from it. What is it? Just kind of like a very limp drama.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, there are some good scenes between some of the characters are really just kind of bland. Like there's the guy who, you know, in the trailer, he wants to spoils war. And then everybody else is like, no, we got to do the mission. It's like, they're just dull. Felton's character is a German Polish man who feels like he doesn't have a home at all, and everybody wants to get him. And I like, there's a nice conversation between his character and Vega's character, just talking about that feeling, because she's a Jewish woman in Russia who just fought the Nazis and is now going back to a Soviet Union that might not, you know, look too happily upon her based on her heritage either. And I like those scenes.
Yeah.
And I really like, kind of out of the blue, I'm not going to say the specifics, but I really, really appreciated the epilogue scene, which ties a nice little bow on a better movie, I think, than this one, a better story, a better theme that it's approaching than this one, which has to do with who tells history and why, and what happens when the people who experience history are no longer around to tell it, what's important about it, and what can happen. I found that captivating. I found everything else about this, which is trying to be, you're right, a horror movie, an action movie, a very, you know, staid drama about the repercussions of war. It doesn't work on either any of those fronts particularly. But the idea at the end that it presents is really tantalizing, and I wish that the rest of the movie had been as strong as that.
Totally agree. It's so intriguing in those moments. It just has no energy or momentum at all. It's so unengaging. I was like, at first, like, why haven't I heard of this movie? Like, as I was starting it and like the premise was starting to reveal itself, I'm like, this sounds like something that should absolutely be on my radar. Like, why aren't they hyping this up? And then you watch the rest of the movie, you're like, oh, it's because it's like a TV movie, like level of engagement. It's just such a boring, like, if you look at Letterboxd, half the reviews are like, it's a perfect movie to take a nap to. Like, it's very mean stuff. Yeah. I'm not going to get that mean with it. I just thought it was like, I don't even want to say it's fine. Like, it's not fine. It is like a step below. Yeah, it's fine. It's a step below that. It's like if I'm giving it out of 4, drum roll, please. It is 2 trademark Roger Ebert thumbs out of 4 for me.
I'm spot on with you on that. It's like, yeah, some good performances, a couple of potentially interesting ideas in there, but it's more about, and I wasn't a big fan of the way the action's shot either, if we're just going to get into it. There's no real sense of, you know, geography or anything.
No, it's just loud. And like, I mentioned the horror elements because I think up top it's like quite violent for a minute and you're like, oh, cool. And then it just doesn't deliver on that ever again, really. Yeah. It's a bummer, disappointing. I mean, I wasn't looking forward to it or anything, so like, it's hard to say disappointing, but like, while watching it, I was like, it was like, you could like chart my excitement. It was like up and down. It was like, I'm so interested, this is cool, and then just plateaued pretty early and never came back. It is, for a 95-minute movie, it's one of those 95-minute movies that you're checking your watch during, and it feels like it's 2 hours long. So, Burial, not great. Sorry, IFC. I love you, IFC Films and IFC Midnight. I appreciate you. I'm sorry that I'm mean to that one. All right. Don't copyright tag me and take this down. By the way, we won the copyright fight on that one. It's back up on YouTube. A timely 3 weeks after the movies came out, when there's, you know, no one's ever going to watch that video, but it's up there if you want to watch it. We beat the Russians yet again. All right. Here's the trailer for Honk for Jesus, Save Your Soul, a movie that I'm not sure if it, I think it premiered at Sundance. I skipped it because I'd heard it wasn't very good, and I'll let that be a tease for the for our review. Here we go.
I just want to clarify some things before we... Before we get started, every woman is not built for the great responsibility of being a first lady.
Pastor Lee Curtis Childs faces allegations of misconduct. His megachurch may never be the same.
Lee Curtis and I, we're going to get to the other side.
You there. Yeah, with the big old microphone. Come in closer, son. You're going to see what all the fuss is about. Showtime.
What's up? Fresh is our turn, baby.
Lee Curtis is a talent, a star. Oh, boy.
We can edit around that, right?
This is going to chronicle the ultimate comeback. I'm Rocky up in this fight.
Rocky didn't win.
But he did win in Rocky 2.
Lord, baby, how many times I got to tell you, get past the first movie? That was all set up.
He is just so wrong. He needs someone to harness it all. Oh, bless your heart. I'm sure plenty of the old congregation will come right on back through good old Wands of the Greater Path to us. You have a blessed one.
Oh, my goodness. And you have a blessed...
That trailer's not a terrible depiction of what the movie is, in that it tries to be very funny and doesn't really land many jokes. I don't know if I'm going to start with like the idea of, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all, or find something nice to say. I will say, another week, another scene stealing turn from Nicole Beharie, who was really terrific in Breaking as like the main teller in that movie during the bank robbery. I would say she's very, very funny in a very small role here, and only really gets to be funny for one scene early on, and then doesn't do much when she returns later. But she's great, and I'm happy to see her and stuff. And I think she just got cast in like The Morning Show season 3 or something. So she's going to be around for a while. Nicole Beharie is great. This movie, Honk for Jesus, Save Your Soul, is like half mockumentary and then half like earnest. We're making a movie that references, you know, the mockumentary within it. It's trying to be like earnest and serious and kind of shine a light on some issues involved in like the Baptist church and mega churches and that culture. But it's like, it's the less generous interpretation of this movie would say it's an unfunny comedy that then tries to pivot into a serious drama, and it doesn't really work on either level for me, despite Regina Hall, who I love, giving a great performance, and Sterling K. Brown, who I love, giving a less, his character is less interesting to me, so like his performance isn't as interesting, but they're both great in this movie that I wish I could recommend, but I just can't. It feels very much like a movie that's based on a 10-minute short film, which it is, and they,
that explains a lot,
doesn't it? It really does. Once that clicked, I'm like, yeah, I'm sure that short is fun and lacerating. But this movie, which like this movie is definitely hindered by the fact that it's just, it's a satire with like such an easy, obvious target that we've already seen parodied a billion times, including like there's an HBO show right now, The Righteous Gemstones, that's calling into attention the hypocrisies of the megachurch people. And there's always material like that out there. Eyes of Tammy Faye just came out last year, a similar movie. It's acting like it's revelatory or something. Like the movie just is like, it thinks calling out the callousness of like a pastor who is, you know, really just like, it's kind of like about the merging of like entertainment and church and the church, and how like a pastor's really just an entertainer, and like how it's kind of just like a grifter kind of guy. They all end up just wanting the celebrity status and the planes and the stuff. But like, it's, again, it's all just, yeah, of course, we've seen this joke a million times before, and the movie offers no new perspective on it. Like, I kept waiting for it to be like, well, there's got to be a pivot or a turn, because surely they didn't just make a movie that's like churches, right? Or isn't it wild how churches are bad and the guys who run them are corrupt? It tries to do, and then the pivot to like seriousness about like depicting their relationship, it all just felt so forced and wrong to me. Sorry, I rambled, so I'll go back within and say, Mark, to you,
yes,
what is Honk for Jesus Save Your Soul?
Honk for Jesus Save Your Soul is basically, yeah, what you described it as. I think it starts off a lot funnier maybe than you did, but that's mainly because it actually does have a target, which is this, you know, this church, this mega church preaching the prosperity gospel. When Sterling K. Brown is up on and preaching, he's really engaging.
Yeah.
And when he has those quiet moments of doubt and everything, he's also very engaging. But the movie itself is much funnier and much better and much more incisive when it is about the church. And it kind of seems to forget to do that. So you have Brown's character as a pastor just up there talking about how, like, oh, you know, the jet and it's not just because, you know, you give me money, it's because I really believe in all this stuff, and you could have a jet too if you believe as much. And yeah, it's an obvious target, but it's at least funny, and it's a target. I'm not 100% sure I'm all aboard of what the movie's getting at with his character, because it's revealed early on that he has some sexual misconduct allegations against him.
Yeah, it's
and
weird.
You think like, okay, he took advantage of some of his parishioners potentially, but the movie kind of holds back a key piece of information to make it be like this twist about halfway through. And I kind of felt like, is the problem here the misconduct, or is the problem here who that misconduct was potentially with and what that says about him as a person, as a man, as a leader? And I think
it's meant to call out like the hypocrisy of it all again, but it's all just, it's such a broad target or whatever.
Not hypocrisy, because it's not, he doesn't preach, as far as I can remember, he doesn't preach against that specific topic ever.
But like the church in general, I guess, would. But like, yeah, that's what I mean.
But nobody talks about it. Nobody talks about it in the movie.
There's
about
no
like
there. Yeah.
It feels a little judgy in a way that I don't think it's intended to be, but it does come across that way. And it's weird because you have this satire in certain parts of Hall's character, you know, encountering all these different people former parishioners who are very judgmental, but put on that happy face and that smile of like, oh no, everything's fine. It's fine. You're doing your thing and it's all good. And I love her performance in the way that she has to put on this big fake smile all the time. And then you have these moments where she just loses it because the pressure of everything is just too much.
Yeah.
There's like a couple of scenes where she just like rolls her eyes very subtly, and it's really funny because she just finds those moments of,
well, she's so funny. She's always,
she is. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. She's a gem. She's fantastic.
Been ringing the hall bell since the original Scary Movie. She's great.
Yeah. Yeah.
This movie, just the script is just completely unfocused until the end. And then, like, before that, it's just, like, a series of bits, which are, like, some funny, some unfunny. But then it tries to be this emotional experience, and it just didn't work for me. I wish it did. This is going to be another, actually, 2 trademarked Roger Ebert thumbs out of 4 for me situation.
Yep, same here.
All right. Well, we did it.
We're gonna disagree eventually. Maybe. Did last week vaguely.
Yeah. Well, I actually have no idea how you feel about this next one, so this will at least be interesting exciting. Here we go. Here's a trailer for Waiting for Bojangles. Apologies if you don't speak French? Romanian or French? That's correct. French. Here you go.
Imagine me and you. I do.
Je jure, n'est plus qu'un menteur. Ça n'existe pas, les parents qui n'ouvrent jamais leur courrier. Une fête avec 300 personnes tous les soirs, c'est ça?
Ça me prend parfois quand je suis summum du bonheur. Je passe à l'extrême inverse sur Krieg. Hein.
Yes, that is Benedetta in the lead role here in Waiting for Bojangles. I hadn't even heard of this movie. Thank you for putting it on my radar, Mark. I actually did enjoy it with reservations, I guess. We'll talk about it. Mark, what is Waiting for Bojangles?
It is a really bad title, but at least
a very bad title. But yeah, like, I get what it's going for. It just like, if that song were more of a like a hit or something, it would be a more relevant thing. If it was like a Beatles or a Rolling Stones song that had that meaning, and then that was the title, like I would totally be more on board with it. But because it's a silly title with a song no one knows, it doesn't really hit for me.
It could be, I mean, it could be a big hit in France for all we know.
Probably. Who knows? Yeah, probably. I'm an ignorant American for sure.
Yeah. So, Virginie Efira plays a woman, a very...
Please call her by her true name of Benedetta.
She's great.
She's wonderful. She's so good.
I did not recognize her right away, but I'm like, I know her from something, and then it clicked. I'm like, oh, that's right.
Yeah. She is Paul Verhoeven's Benedetta.
Yeah. So she's playing a completely different role this time around. So she's a woman, very ethereal, very mysterious, very quirky, you could say, at least at the start, when Romain Duress's character meets her at a party on the Riviera, which seems like this fantastically romantic setting. And they have this whirlwind romance where they're just kind of joking around about how they're both sort of lying about who they are, and they have like different personas that they put on just to impress people and just to have some fun. And they start dancing and everything seems great. They run off to a church and they marry themselves. And then he wakes up in the morning and she's gone, and she goes looking for her because she stole his car. And it all feels very, very happy. And you have no clue. Like, you just think it's like taking it at face value. It feels so, I don't even know how to say it. It just feels so pointedly eccentric to the point where it's just, you know, you feel like you know where this movie is going. They end up moving to Paris. They have a kid. The kid gets beat up because everybody thinks he's lying about how
he inherits their eccentric bullshit traits.
Correct.
Of like embellish eccentricities where you're embellishing. You're just, and the kids think he's lying, but actually, what's interesting is he's not, because the kid is just like, hey, I live this crazy life. My parents are nuts. They have people over every night. There's 300 people in my house and there's parties, and the kids don't believe him, but he's actually telling the truth.
Correct. Yeah, he's being honest about it. Yeah, they leave this big pile of mail in the corner. They don't open their mail.
And that is such a good detail of like, it is a really nice detail. And not only is it a good detail for characterization, but like just like the visual of him tossing it and the huge pile of it. It's very silly. And like I was like grasping for like, what can I compare this movie to tonally, to like let people know what they're in for? And I was really struggling. And like the closest I could come, and tell me if I'm crazy off base, is like in terms of purely in tone, I would say it's like Raising Arizona, where it's like the hijinks that you're watching should be totally concerning. And it's like fucked up, like parents kidnapping children in that movie. And this one, it's not quite that, but it's like these two fucked up people had a kid, and now this kid has to live in the world with these fucked up parents. So it's like should be upsetting, but the way it's handled, it's like silly and endearing and sweet. Until this movie, it becomes actually concerning, I would say, at certain points.
Yes. Yeah.
I don't know. Tell me what you think about that comparison.
Oh yeah. I mean, that's where I'm trying to like set up the mood here, where I'm like, what the movie's doing and how I'm feeling about the movie, where it feels like this feels a bit too cute and too cutesy for
the
good
material. Yeah.
And then suddenly you start to realize, oh, this movie is actually addressing the fact that this is a lot more than just eccentricity. And it's a lot more than just a guy completely head over heels in love with a woman. It's about what is wrong with this woman, specifically what's wrong with her, and what is wrong with the fact that he is doing all of this to keep up this illusion and this this feeling of being completely in love with her this entire time. And it actually addresses those ideas, which makes it a lot deeper and makes it a lot more serious. It's not as funny, obviously, as it starts to go. Yeah. And I was not expecting that, but yeah, it works.
I would say I agree. It works. Like, there's a scene where, I guess it's a spoiler, but like, the movie evokes like being lobotomized, like fucking McMurphy in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest or something. And like, it's like a troubling image. And yeah, I don't know. The movie, it's a very, I don't know how to categorize this movie too. It's very all over the place in terms of mood, very silly, but also somber. But I found it, you know, imminently watchable, and I really enjoyed it. And I definitely, spoiler alert, skip to the end of like, I'm gonna give it 3 out of 4 Roger Ebert thumbs. I really like trademarked Roger Ebert thumbs. I don't want anyone coming at me. But it's also like, I don't quite know what to make of it. Like, I didn't walk away with like totally understood what the theme and the message of this was. I just definitely enjoyed the ride, and like, I'm excited to read more about it and learn like what that movie, like what the director was trying to say. But like, there are so many compelling scenes, especially like the one where the kid gets beat up at school and he's explaining to his mom what happened, and he's just making up this fantastical bullshit story. And then she like tells him after, and she like encourages that behavior, and then is like, you know, you can tell me what really happened, but like, whisper that in my ear. And then out loud to the world, they still only talk about the fantastical nice version of what happened. And like, the idea of like, when reality is banal and sad, you just make up a fabulous story, and all that stuff is very interesting. And I just don't quite know what to make of like the pivot to like, oh, she's got problems and now we have to like keep up this life to like live like her. I don't know. Like, and it ends in a very dark place, and it's just I feel like it's a very French movie, and that my American mind can't wrap around it, you know.
I'm wondering if there, because it's based on a novel, and the novel apparently was really big in France and elsewhere. I don't know if it really crossed over here yet or not, because I hadn't heard about the book at all until the movie came out. So I don't know if there's I kept having the suspicion, like, is all this stuff actually happening, or is it
fantastical reality?
The kids' understanding of how it happened. And I don't know if the book kind of gets into that. And here we're supposed to take it all at face value, but you do wonder, like, I had this thought afterwards, like, is the book like the narrator? Is the narrator the kid, like, grown up? And this is potentially a story that he's telling himself and other people about.
Yeah.
Because it does. Yeah, it does get very, very dark by the end.
It gets very dark, but it's never not compelling. And like, once you realize what it's doing, it's just about being like getting on the level of your partner. And like, in this movie, it happens to be like, that means you're gonna be doing things that like a mentally ill person might do, and like, that's okay, have fun and enjoy it.
But
and
is like, it okay? Because I mean, I
you know, is it okay? Because look at this kid's life, right?
Yeah, like, and look at where everything ends up. I mean, there's a, and I think the film does question that, whether or not this is really, because, you know, it's not just all fun and games, and it's not just all like consequences to everything. Like, in bigger terms, there are scenes where like the husband or Duress's character has to like just, he has like the scene of just watching TV with the son, and he just starts breaking down crying. And you know, like, because it's just so much like of not knowing, like, did he do the right thing? Is he doing the right thing now? Should he? I think it's not my concern was that the cutesy tone of the beginning would eventually move into the depiction of mental illness. And I think it does a good job separating out when it's just being cute for its own sake, and when it is actually trying to address mental illness and how it affects the people around people who have it. And
another, go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah. I just think that separation is key where it doesn't feel like it's turning mental illness into something eccentric and cutesy.
No, like it's just like, it's kind of also like, you know, it's set in the 60s in a time when people didn't know how to deal with that type of stuff. So like a whimsical tale of these, of this family amidst that is kind of like an endearing thing to do, like an endearing movie to make. And I like appreciate that. And I'm just kind of now coming to like, what kind of, like, I'm trying to make another comparison. And I'm like, it's almost like, this is going to maybe be a crass comparison because it's a Holocaust movie, but like, it reminded me of like Life is Beautiful almost, right? Where like that movie's about a guy making his time in the Holocaust in the concentration camp, like palpable, like an enjoyable experience for his son. And this movie's not dissimilar in that it's like a family trying to make the most of a bad situation by kind of altering the reality around them, right?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I get the comparison. Yeah. I mean, it's, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, it's an very interesting movie. I quite enjoyed it, and I will be thinking about it for quite a while. And it does feel like a movie that you'd get a lot from on the second viewing. And after you read the, like, it makes me want to read the book, which is a big compliment.
Yeah, that's always a good, that's always a good compliment.
Where did you end up on it?
Yeah, I give it 3.2. Yeah, it works. It
works weirdly, despite all that craziness that we've described.
Yeah.
And oh man, this is going to be an interesting one to talk about. This movie is coming to Shudder next week. It's in theaters in limited release now. It's called Saloum. It played at festivals. We'll talk about it. Let's get into it. Here's the trailer.
Le ciné Saloum, la meilleure des planques pour des mercenaires en cavale.
3 jours ici et tout le monde nous aura oubliés. On se connaît.
J'ai gardé un très bon souvenir de cet endroit.
Quelqu'un joue à nous la mettre.
Qu'est-ce qui vous amène dans notre magnifique région du Cine Saloum?
Éducation et culture.
Il s'en sert pour préparer quelque chose. Quelque chose qu'il ne nous dit pas.
C'est parti du Saloum et Moudita jamais.
Man, oh man, I'm excited to talk about this movie, mostly because it'll actually be hard to talk about because I don't want to spoil anything and I don't want to give away anything. But without doing that, I can say I can't remember the last time I was so into the first half of a movie and so like disappointed by the second half. I did not need the pivot that happens at about the halfway point. But man, I don't want to harp on what it is or why it doesn't work. I guess we can a little bit maybe later. But I thought it was absolutely terrific up until that point. Like, and it's still good enough to recommend, even though it ends up biting off way more than it can chew and like jumping to another genre, even though it was already doing genre mashup so well. Mark, what is Saloum?
Saloum is about a team of mercenaries in Africa who go around, I think it's 2003 is when it's set, and they're in Guinea-Bissau, and they are but they're a military coup is happening, and they're kind of on the sidelines performing these various missions. Like in this one, they're looking for a Mexican drug dealer who happens to be in the country, and he pays them off for safe passage on the plane they have. They get on the plane has some gasoline problems, we'll say. They had some fuel issues, and they land in the eponymous Saloum, which is this area. There used to be a kingdom of legend in Senegal, and they end up at this commune and this camp down the river. And you know, it's just them just kind of like trying to hide out at first and try to play some mind games. There's a woman there who is deaf and mute, and she knows who they are. There is a police captain there who also knows who they are.
Yes.
And they're trying to kind of downplay the fact about who they are and lie about who they are to everyone else. And so it's interesting, like all these mind games going on and this game cat and mouse kind of
interesting dynamics. Yeah.
Yeah. It's it starts off really interesting and you don't know where it's quite going to go. It starts talking about, you know, conflict and experiencing it. And the fact that there is like the man who runs the place, he's named Omar. He runs this commune and he and the lead mercenary have this like long conversation, not too long, but, you know, a sizable conversation about the very number of conflicts that they've experienced over their years of being a soldier or mercenary. And it's just, you know, it feels like there's something going on about conflict. I mean, just on its foundational level and what it is, the nature of it, how it just continues and everything. And the movie kind of literalizes it as a metaphor, as a horror movie eventually. That's probably the best way to put it. And I'm not even 100% sure if the horror threat is necessarily a embodiment of that idea or if it's just a neat gimmick. I don't know. I'm not 100%.
I think it's definitely trying to be like metaphor alert, like the CGI swarm represents X. Like it's definitely trying to do that. Yeah. And that's where I think it errs big time. Yeah. Like I just didn't need the pivot. Like it's the only thing I compare it to is From Dusk Till Dawn. It's a very From Dusk Till Dawn pivot, which in that movie, it really works. And it's so surprising. And like one of the coolest things you can do in life as a movie fan is show a movie fan who's never seen that movie and doesn't know anything about it. Just have them sit down and watch it with them. And it's so fun because it's such a shocking twist and it does take the movie to another level. And if you're not expecting it, it's really a joy. When this movie did it, I was so into what came before and what came after that was so lame that I was completely taken out of it. I love all the dynamics that are building right before that reveal and like the child soldier stuff that comes out. And there's just it's shot really, you know, kinetically and exciting. And as like, I definitely am recommending it still. It's like, as like this foreign film and African film, it's like definitely trying to do this genre mashup of so many type of things. It feels very Tarantino. It feels very Carpenter. I definitely admire it so much. I just really, it really, really, really lost me when it pivots to we're fighting a horde of CGI flies, basically. Like, it is such a bummer that the whole second half is that, because the first half is so, like, I just, like, the twistiness of it all and, like, the fact that, like, the deaf person knows who they are, but no one else speaks sign language. So like,
except the mercenaries, which makes it
so much more fun. And all the other people just sitting there while they talk and have no idea what's going on. And then there's the cop who has his own like plan and allegiances or whatever. It's just, it's such a fun movie of like, when you think it's, at least I thought it was such a fun movie when I thought it was just like allegiances shifting and like childhood trauma coming back and the bastard, you know, the idea of colonization being ripe for horror and local folklore, all that mashing together is so cool. It just like when it becomes CGI manifestations of shit, it didn't need it. It just doesn't need it. And
no,
like,
it doesn't. No, and you're right, because I forgot about the moment right before the shift.
I know. It's the best moment.
That is a moment. That's like a huge, huge moment.
It's like the climactic moment where if the movie like ended there, I would have been like, bravo, this short film is great. Like,
yeah. It could have. I mean, there is a very specific thing it's trying to address, which is, I mean, it's brought up right at the beginning of the movie. It's about revenge, and revenge is like a river. And I found the idea and the visualization of that, because there's this like really haunting, like you don't know what it is, but it's like somebody in the water and they talk about revenge being like a river and you don't get to the end until you reach the bottom and you drown. And the person just like disappears, I think, into the river. Yeah. And it's like, it's a really, you know, striking metaphor that it's basically the dig two graves metaphor, but with a river and everything. Yeah. And I think the movie, but that's what the movie is about up until that point when it becomes about the insects. And it's okay. It's
okay. It's like, you know, that everyone has to forget their troubles with each other to team up and take on this issue. And like, it just becomes more generic and uninteresting.
It does.
Like, it was such a unique, I had never seen this, you know, obviously it's a very specific culture that I've never seen in a movie before. And like, it was such a specific thing that when it went from like the specificity of the first act to the generic horror of the third act, or even the second half of the movie, it just completely upended what I thought was good about it. But that doesn't mean that like these filmmakers aren't ones to watch. Like Jean-Luc Herbelou, whoever made this movie, and the writer Pamela Diop, they're absolutely talent to watch. Like this, I love the way this movie looks. I think it's shot really well. I think it's cut really well. It just like on a level, you know, on like a story level or like on like a entertainment movie level, it completely lost me halfway through and like it never got me back. And that sucks because it really feels like I was watching a 4.5, 5-star movie, or on a Ebert scale, it was a 3.5, 4-bagger. And I was really enjoying it. I was like, this is going to be the best Shudder movie maybe ever. This is great. And then it pivots. And I was like, oh, no. Oh, no. And I kept waiting for it to come back, but it never did. Yeah. But it sounds like I'm damning with faint praise. But it shouldn't feel that way, because that first half is so strong. It makes the movie worth recommending, even though I don't like the second half. Like, that's how strong it is. And like, it ends up averaging out to a 3. It's one of those situations where it's a 3 out of 5 for me and a 3 out of 4.
There you go.
Is it a 3 out of 4 for you, I'm presuming?
It's a 3 out of 4, but it's a 3 out of 5, but it's a 2.5 out of 4.
So you feel the same way I do, but like even more strongly, or is there another issue you have?
I think it works as two separate movies, or at least half of two separate movies that never come together. It is one half of a movie and one half of a story, and then it's a completely different half of a movie, a completely different story. It doesn't quite, they each work on their own to a certain point, but they never come together for me. And that's enough for me to say like, no, it's not quite a recommendation for me.
Okay.
It looks great. It's shot really well. The performances are really strong. It's a better mind game movie about this team of mercenaries trying to get what they want and everybody trying to figure out who they are. And it's a less okay creature feature. And you know, but both of those, they don't gel.
And like, I appreciate that it's like borrowing from a million genres and like is kind of like, you know, a love letter to make the movies or whatever you can say it is, because it's just like a low budget, like exploitation movie or trying to be. And like, I definitely appreciate all of that, but I just wish it came together better.
Yeah.
And it doesn't, but I still gotta rep it. I think it's strong. I think it's so strong, that first half, that you know, shut it off at the 48 shut it off at 48 minutes or whatever it is, right after a big reveal happens.
You'll know
it's like a very climactic, exciting moment.
It is the most momentous thing that happens in the movie, and it would have been great to see an actual movie deal with the fallout of that, both on a psychological level and in terms of the way that that story is set up, what would have happened based on what happens. Yeah, there's a very, very strong movie in there, I think. But that's not this one. It turns into just a horror movie that's not quite as interesting.
Bummer. All right, so we're back next week. Clerks 3, Medieval, Barbarian. Is House of Darkness really coming out?
Yeah, House of Darkness is...
There's another Neil LaBute movie, folks, and it is horror adjacent. I'm not going to call it a straight up... It's a horror movie, but it's a Neil LaBute play, like one scene chamber drama horror movie. What else is there?
Speak No Evil is getting limited release that week.
Hell yeah.
And then it'll be on Shudder.
if you can see Speak No Evil in the theater, I recommend it. I quite like it. I just rewatched it this morning after watching it at Sundance in January. Loved it then. Love it even more now. Spoiler alert. We'll talk about it.
We will definitely be talking about it.
Yeah, so that's a lot of good stuff next week. That episode will be out on Friday. It'll just be out like late Friday, like probably Friday evening, because I have to catch up on Barbarian because I'm missing the only screening because I'm out of town. So there you have it, folks. We'll be back next week with all the new releases. This was all the new releases for this week, the week of September 2nd. It's Friday, September 2nd. Happy September. Bye.
The show starts in one.
Shut up. Ush.